a very warm welcome to Gandey.
300 days a year, this circus tours England and Wales, a self-contained community of 57 people and 19 animals. They'll perform 640 shows, travel 2,300 miles, and manhandle the big top into position 78 times. But for how much longer? Are those circus days numbered?
We commence the performance here this evening with our beautiful Bactrian camels presented on horseback by Carol McManus.
Some weeks the audience roll up in their thousands. Other times only a few hundred will be watching the performers like Carol McManus, for whom circus is not just a job, it's her life.
I have been away from circus. I went out of circus for a short while, 6 months, to a job, but still with horses. So, always animals.
Yet it's because of acts like this that Gandey's, the Cheshire-based circus, is barred from an increasing number of public parks in Britain.
About 6 years ago, we was doing all the parks in Birmingham, every single park in Birmingham, which was green, like a putting pitch of nice parks, nice for people to come and see a circus. But now we've got to go up to farmers' fields, we've got to go up bits of derelict land, which is not good for us, and not good like for the animals as well, really.
Circus is under attack as never before. 180 local authorities throughout the country have now banned animal circuses. Some members of parliament are adding their support.
I believe, and many of my colleagues believe, that it departs from the dignity of animals to have them doing tricks and that kind of thing. But that's one thing. But the other problem, of course, is that with the restricted sites that we have available nowadays, the circus crammed on a little industrial site or an old bomb site isn't the best way to deal with animals. And trundling animals around the country in vans and that kind of thing really is outdated.
Circus is here. It's going to change. I mean, circus always changes. It always evolves, but it's always going to be there.
So why, despite determined attempts to close them down, do the big tops still draw enough people willing to pay to keep them on the road? Close Up North spent a week with Britain's oldest travelling circus on its annual summer tour of North Wales. There were no restrictions on what was filmed. 20 years ago, the circus only employed 6 people. Philip Gandey was 17 when his father died.
So then it was a case of, what do we do? You know, I'd always been with the circus in the school holidays, and it was a case of either finishing it completely or sort of biting the bullet and trying to keep it going. So we kept it going. But like a lot of small businesses, it was the whole business side was in my father's head. And of course, when he went, you know, we were sort of floundering around, really. More and more now, circus has had to sort of come into the 20th century, become a business with all the backups of modern business and able to survive.
Crucial to that survival was a university business graduate whose first visit to a circus was to change her life.
I was purely interested in the lifestyle as an art form, as a business, and the whole thing, you know, the animals, the animal training, and all that. I was such an unusual way of life. And I did 6 months. And it was brilliant. I was really impressed with the whole thing.
Carol and Philip Gandey's marriage underpins an extremely successful business partnership.
Probably 90% of all those young people working on the circus are not from circus families, which means that people are actually saying, I don't want to work in a factory, I don't want to work for the civil service, I don't want to work here. I'm going to stop my life, I'm going to move out of a house, I'm going to move into a caravan, I'm going to join the circus, which means that circus is continually now getting new blood from different walks of life. We're getting this new blood coming into circus all the time, which means it's going to continue.
The second performance of the day has just ended. The next show will start in 18 hours' time, but in another town 25 miles away.
We're doing short stands at the moment, so every day is basically the same. I mean, it's day in, day out, work, work, work.
Paul is one half of the Digits. Trevor Steele is the other. They're billed as Europe's smallest, funniest clowns.
Right, this is the serious part of it. Build it up and pull it in.
We all muck and everybody does something. It's not like a theatre when you get your performers and you get your stage staff. Everybody gets involved in everything, so therefore you've got more of a feel. I suppose it's the atmosphere. It's just the atmosphere. You couldn't describe it unless you actually live on a circus and actually become part of a circus. You couldn't describe the atmosphere.
As the 2 tons of plastic tent is lowered onto its trailer, a week of non-stop rain has seriously delayed the move. The wet equipment and soft ground absorb a great deal of time, effort and patience.
It's hard when it's raining. But you just get used to it. I get used to it anyway, I like it. That's why I've been here 10 years.
You've got to know what you're doing, you've got to know what everybody else is doing, and you've got to be on the ball all the while, that sort of thing.
Right, Binky, yours! Wait! Got to touch more!
It's quite a big circus to shift about, you know, like for 2 or 3 days. With Wales, a lot of the sites are like quite small farmers' fields or small parks.
Some people think there is good money in circuses. It is and it isn't. And people think it's all glamour. All the people come to circuses, you see, you work in the ring. And they think, that is it, full stop.
Okay, one, two. Go on, one, two.
They don't see us like in 2 foot of mud, you know, mudded up and pulling a tent down in rain, and nobody ever sees that, only us.
Yeah, you either like circus or you don't. We did 2 shows the other day, pulled down, built up in the night. Two shows today, pulled down, build up again tonight, two shows, pulled down, and then we have a day out at Hollywood.
All right. Get under. Binky? Okay?
The difficulties of raising the big top in bad weather and on soft ground means that the rest time is limited to 3 hours.
For times like this, when we're doing a 2-day stand, it's quite hard work to actually do the 2-day stand, just because of the fact that normally we'd be doing all this for a week, so everybody's got a week to wind down again, but the fact is we're moving again tomorrow night and doing another 2-day stand.
It gets tiring, but you get into a routine.
The hours are long, the pay is short.
It's not a great payer. I personally, even as a management, don't believe that people get enough money for the jobs they're doing, but then again, as a company, we're very much governed by market forces and what we can actually afford to pay them. I'd like to think we pay them as much as possible to do the job, but not when you consider that it is a 24-hour day. You can't go home at 5 o'clock and forget about it until 9 o'clock the following morning, because you actually live there, which means that basically if there's a problem, if the wind blows or the site's bad, you can be on call 24 hours a day. So if you break that down into an hourly rate, it doesn't add up to a lot of money at all.
I think probably a lot of people that are attracted to circus are hyperactive people. They're people that get a thrill out of the adrenaline flow. People that don't stick it are the people that don't have a capacity for working 24 hours a day.
Musician Michaela Bromage is one who couldn't stick it. She's leaving after 6 months.
It's hard, very hard. It's a hard life. It's, you know, it's always cold, no shower. muddy grounds, hard work, called at 4 in the morning, to build the tent up and put the drums up at 4. And I'm just exhausted. And I've got calluses on my hands. And it's just, it's just too hard for me. I cut out for it.
I was born in circus, so it's actually in the blood. I've tried doing other things, brick laying, pipes, I did a bit of temp driving and various other jobs. But I just couldn't, because it's a set time, it's a 40 hours a week, you know, it's got to get up at 8 o'clock, finish at 5. Whereas this job, sometimes we don't have to get up until 8, 10. I mean, we don't have to work all the time. I mean, as long as the animals are outside in their exercise pen, we can leave them for a couple of hours so we can, enjoy the sun for a little bit.
Ready with only 2 hours to spare. But after a long, hard night's work, will enough people turn up to make it worth the effort?
The last time we actually cancelled a show because there weren't enough people would probably be sort of 10 years ago when we were a lot smaller. I mean, there are always X number of people that turns up. I mean, quite often, weekday performances, that isn't enough to cover the expenses of actually doing the show. But obviously, some of these people may have been planning this for a couple of weeks. We're going to take the kids to the circus. And you can imagine the excitement building up in the house at home. I mean, I've got children. We're going to the circus tonight.
Send us £7, please.
To go to the Big Top and to actually go there. And somebody turns around and says, oh, I'm sorry, kids, we're not doing it tonight, I mean, it's not their fault, it's the other 900 or 1,000 that didn't turn up. It's their fault, so we always shout,
Hello, Gandey Circus, can I help you? Ringside chairs at £10 for adults, £8 for children.
If you were going to actually get the money together to put a circus on the road, I think any financial advisor would say don't and leave it in the bank.
For children.
Yeah. Do you like the programme?
No, thanks, a lovely thing.
I mean, you're talking about a medium-sized Big Top costing £50,000 or £60,000 for the 1,000 seats that go in it. You're talking about another £70,000 or £80,000. So purely the Big Top and seating already, you've gone through sort of £170,000 before you even start on the trucks, the lights. So I mean, £500,000 maybe get you somewhere down the road to a quite a nice 1,000-seat circus, but then you've got to run it. The biggest proportion of the outgoings each week do go on the artists' salaries because at the end of the day, that is the product. Everything else is just packaging. The artists are what you're selling the performance. And of course that, does tend to be the problem because in hard times, that is the most tempting thing to say, okay, well, if we take those two acts out, we can lose perhaps £1,000 worth of outgoings each week. But at the end of the day, that then becomes a vicious circle because that is the product, that's what you're selling. If you start cutting the quality of the product down, then it's a vicious circle. The people don't come and the whole thing goes down.
Unlike many other British performing arts, circus doesn't attract any form of subsidy.
The government basically take a lot of tax and VAT and PAYE from us and nothing else. Now that we're coming into Europe, unlike the Italians, for instance, where the government actually turns around to Italian circus, and I don't know the exact figures, but it's somewhere in the region of £1 million, £1.5 million a year, and gives it to Italian circus. Now, I'm not saying that out-and-out circus should be given these enormous grants, but at least recognise the fact that we exist, recognise the fact that the Circus Proprietors Association of Great Britain exists, and just give us the sites. We'll do the rest.
The circus exists at all is through tradition, not legislation. Anyone can set up a circus. There's no licensing, no need for wild animal certificates. They don't even need public liability insurance. All of which disturbs Malcolm Clay, a lawyer from Blackburn in Lancashire. He's also secretary of the Circus Proprietors Association.
Circuses, of course, are a perfectly lawful business, and they are a big business. Government really isn't sure which department should have responsibility for them. Should it be the Home Office? Should it be the Department of the Environment? I think circuses have really given up on government and said, we will show you what needs to be done. But people ought to realise that there is this lack of legislation.
After four performances, the circus moves on again. But lack of legislation means different rules and regulations in every new town and village.
Each person has got a different idea on how the circus ought to be operated. So we can be doing things apple pie for Mr. Environmental Officer in Blackburn, but we can move 15 miles down the road and that can be all wrong, all got to be changed. Very, very frustrating.
One, two. It's not a long jump, we're only going 12 miles tonight. We'll be there by 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock this morning.
But the deteriorating weather and narrow Welsh roads would add another few hours onto that estimate. The site is at the bottom of a very steep grassy slope. But first, a narrow gateway had to be negotiated or demolished.
That saved me going in the other gate, it's wider than the gate now.
Local authorities have very little involvement with circuses. There are no bylaws or other acts which entitle councils to control circuses, other than the Performing Animals Regulation Act of 1925. What has traditionally happened is that the circus has used the council park, and it's as landlord of that site that the council has been able to impose control on questions of animal welfare and public liability insurance. Of course, when a circus moves onto a private site, then there is no control at all.
Come back a couple of inches when I shout.
Orlando! The ritual raising of the big top seems to defy the elements and the critics who claim its popularity is waning. They say audiences are only a fraction of those of 40 years ago.
When you're talking about the large circuses of the 50s and mid-60s, they were seating about 4,500 people. Now that is a lot of people to get into any event these days, any live event, twice a day, 7 days a week. You're talking about enormous a lot of people, much more than the West End theatres seat, and they've got the blockbuster musicals and they're only playing once nightly. So when people say that circus has shrunk, it's only shrunk in comparison with any other live entertainment as per the number of people that actually go along and attend it. You know, the circus is no different than any other live entertainment.
Well, Luby, come on down.
But many would argue that performing Luby, animals down. Make a world of difference.
Luby. Circuses definitely got to be with animals. I wouldn't like to work in a circus without animals. Definitely from the animal rights people, we get, you know, you get quite a bit of hassle from them, but I mean, we get by. I mean, we can survive on it.
There are no cage acts with Gandey Circus at this moment because, unlike the other European countries, obviously we've got that little bit of water that separates us from Europe, and we do have a quarantine. So there are a limited number of wild animal acts, for want of a better word, lions, tigers, in the country. We visit the same towns every year, and rather than have to keep using a lion or a tiger act, which our audience has probably seen 2 or 3 years ago, leave them out.
But in the 1990s, should circuses be using wild animals?
They're not, of course, born in the wild. They're all captive bred. They're all ex-zoo stock, which in most cases, if circuses didn't use these lions and tigers, surplus zoo stock is another word for saying we're going to have to kill it.
Go on.
The state of circus with animal protesters, I mean, I don't know if there's going to be wild animals in circus in the next 5 years. I mean, I hope there will be. If there's not, then obviously, if I didn't spray or mechanic or be tent master, I'd be stuck, because without animals in circus, that means I wouldn't have a job. If the elephants didn't like me or didn't trust me, I wouldn't get them out of the truck. An elephant has to trust you before they go anywhere. How I look at it, I'm the father and they're my children. I like have to care for them and they look up to me like I'm their father.
I think it would be very hard for me to have found a job or a lifestyle that could have been quite as challenging as the one I've been lucky enough to fall across. I really think that God smiled on me.
An old saying, which is, it's very, very easy to get a speck of sawdust in your blood, but it's even harder to get it out again.
the end of the day, when the great British public stops putting their hand in the pockets and saying, we're not going to pay to see Circus Performing Animals anymore, we won't be here.
Stay tuned for the number to ring to take part in tonight's local radio phone-in on circuses. Starting in a few moments on your BBC local radio station, Close Up Talk offers the opportunity to have your say on whether animals should be used in circuses. Dial 0345 951 951 now. For the cost of a local call, wherever you live in the Northwest, you can put your point to those who run the circus and those who campaign for their closure. That's Close Up Talk on BBC GMR, Radio Merseyside and Radio Lancashire, beginning in a few moments' time. That number again, 0345... See too after Homer gets some home help.
Why? At the beginning of the season, I just didn't know how things worked.
Yeah.
Hey, Coach. Can I talk to you for a minute?
Yeah, Patrick, sure. Sit down. Here, chair. What's going on?
I've been studying with his tutor, a graduate student in the English department.
Yeah.
He offered to take my Western Civ midterm for me. I don't know what to do. I mean, I know a lot of guys do that, but I want to know if it's okay if I take my own exam. I want to do well here. I mean, I'm a good linebacker, but I want to get better. So if that's what I need to do, if I should let the guy take my test, then I will. I just want to know if that's the way it's supposed to go.
Take your own test.
Okay, good. Good.
There's something else?
It's just a little weird. Well, the tutors, the cars, the girls. I mean, I read about stuff like this in the sports magazines. I just... You know, we're just playing football, right?